Angie show. It's a terrible thing to show up in the church without the Holy Ghost. It's a terrible thing to show up into the meeting and your spirit's bigger than the Holy Spirit. It's an ugly thing. I want you to stuff that back in. Amen. Hallelujah. Stuff that back in there. Hallelujah. Just let the beauty of his glory, let the beauty of his presence. He's done such a wonderful thing for us, you know. He's baptized us in his presence. So that we look like it. Hallelujah. He's so taharane. Filled us, horomase toya. Filled us with his spirit. Hallelujah. So we act like it. Manae shehati. Hallelujah. Who remande shea pana ke. She mongedesh te pirinishi. Remande de brunos te dea. It is a limitless supply that God would have for you to grow in. An ever-increasing faith that you stand at the crossroads of decision, continually deciding what you will have. Many people decide they will have their frustration. I can't imagine why. They decide they will have, you know, their stuff, their decisions, their insight. They decide they'll have whatever it is, you know, that, you know, in many people, in the real true sincerity and earnestness to do what's right, they just do it on their own. It's a wonderful thing when you just turn yourself over to the Holy Spirit and find yourself that in this realm where praising him and giving thanks to the living God becomes the means by which every opposition is overthrown, whichever enemy of your soul is defeated, which every distraction that would try to draw you away from looking unto the author and finisher of your faith. People say, how can I increase in faith? Look unto the author and finisher of your faith. People say, how can I increase in faith? Do the word, even when it seems like it's impossible for you to do the word, just do the word. Just believe the word, even when everything says it's not true, just believe the word. Because Bible's looking for some people who will walk by faith and not by sight, not by their perceptions. And this is a hard lesson to learn. This is the challenge. I mean, this is the big one. You know, this is where it all comes down to, whether you're going to walk after that which is unseen and respond to that which is unseen. We look unto or we respond to those things that are unseen rather than looking or responding to those things which are seen. Why? Because we walk by faith, not by sight, not by our perception. And sight takes us all in all the five senses, all the realms of that which our experience has taught us. To now learn to hear the word of God, it's a different sense. Hallelujah. It's a different realm. To hear the word of God, now to live by the word of God. And the word of God produces the faith that we now live in and that we walk in. Instead of walking by the perception, we walk by the word of God, which produces a supernatural working of faith. I'm going to tell you right now, you just be faithful with God and you just throw down and you stop everything that would oppose the word of God and you're going to be successful. I don't care what all you go through. It doesn't matter what all. You know, you decide what the timeline's going to look like. You decide based upon your willingness to surrender everything to God and walk with him. You decide what the timeline's going to be looking like. Because I've watched people step into this thing of this God, that God has given, and they never really fully surrender to the Lord. They still hold on to their own life in this world. But if we're just simply willing to take up what he's given to us. Listen, there are so many people in the community of the kingdom of God, among the children of the living God. They've never been willing to take up the power and the authority that God has given to us to deal with every thought and every imagination that is contrary to him. There are thoughts and imaginations which he inspires from his word, and then there's the thoughts and imaginations which are contrary to him. People are passive about it. They're not active. They're passive. They just let whatever comes in their minds sit there and occupy their mind. They go with it. They listen to it. They respond to it. They build structures out of it. They make life decisions out of it. It's about time you learn how to live a sanctified life. Hallelujah. It's about time you learn how to live consecrated to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God. Yes. Well, because we've been sanctified by the Holy Ghost unto obedience. We've been sanctified by the sprinkling of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, to where we can now live all of our life in the Holy Ghost and be led by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Walk in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise God. Live in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Having our citizenship in heaven, having our conversation in heaven, having our authority in heaven, being seated there in a heavenly realm. And it's days of heaven upon earth because we simply obey God. I mean, it was days of heaven upon the earth for those in Deuteronomy 11. Obey God. How much more for us if we'll obey God? We just simply want to just do it our own way, think it our own way, walk by sight, not by faith. It ain't going to work out for you. That's going to be miserable. I'm going to just tell you right now, it's going to be frustrating. People say, Pastor, what's wrong with me? You walk by sight. That's what's wrong with you. Pastor, why can't I step into the things of the Spirit? Because you not listening to the Word and living by the Word. Hearing the Word of God, obeying the Word of God. Hallelujah. There's things that the Spirit of the Lord would produce in your life tonight. All you got to do is grab a hold of the Word of God. Amen. And, you know, we worship and we praise for the single purpose of you being filled with the Spirit, of you being awakened if you're sleeping, to the things of the Spirit of the living God so that you can respond to God. Because man out of his own human ability and out of his own human understanding can't respond to God. It doesn't fit. It's an unseen realm. In this world of temporalness, in this world of earthly existence, we function and navigate based upon what is seen. What our sight dictates to us. And what we feel we should do with our lives based upon the circumstances, and most of those things we're just running scared, huh? We got, you know, we've had crazy cows. We call them. They're scared of everything, spooked by everything, and it's so sad. You'd think that the cows that are at peace would just influence the scared ones. Nope, the ones that are scared, they start running. Everybody starts running. And I look at that go on and over and again. I thought, there it is. That's people. It's just humanity. It's just that the spirit of the world does the same thing to human beings as it does to animals. And the Lord came in his goodness and his mercy, and he delivered us from bondage so that we don't have to fear anymore. We don't have to live in the insecurity. We don't have to live in the intimidation. We don't have to live in the uncertainty of tomorrow. We don't have to live out of the realms of all that men live in and their stress that comes from their worry. But he's given us the spirit of his son. Oh, hallelujah. I have the spirit of Christ Jesus. I have the spirit of the only begotten Son of God. That spirit has been brought into my life so that Father could reveal his son through me so that I could live in the glorious liberty, hallelujah, the sons of God, so I could walk around in the authority. And Father is going to have this fruit. Father is going to have people. His eyes go to and fro throughout the earth right now looking for anyone who's crying out to him saying, Lord, I want this in my life. Lord, I give myself over to you. And he sees us standing there resolved and committed to the cause. You know, I was sharing this morning that the other day I accidentally ran a wire up between my fingernail and my finger. And it was so intensely painful. And I'm thinking, wow, this should have quit hurting now. But it didn't because it was just so painful. And, you know, I begin to think about, yeah, that's why they used it for torture in World War I, World War II. And I began in Korean War. And I began to, and even in Vietnam War. And I begin to think about these men who were, especially during World War II, POWs, who were taken and waterboarded for 72 hours and kept awake and then tortured with all kinds of torture like that. And then trying to get information out of them, they wouldn't give any information. And taken again. And tortured for 72 hours by not letting them go to sleep for different things. All they could just fall asleep. As soon as they fall asleep, they wake them up. And then bring them back into a room of intense torture and you know, examination for a couple hours. And they never gave up information. And they did it without the Holy Ghost. They did it because they were committed to a cause. Huh? It's about time God's people understand what Father has given to us and get committed to a cause and then understand where that then goes when we are now living under the authority of the Holy Ghost. Come on, man. Come on now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father deserves better. Amen. Hallelujah. He deserves better. He deserves the people who will be consecrated to him. After all that he's done for us, he deserves the people to be separated and sanctified. What else you got going on anyways that's so much better, huh, than doing the works of the Father, than living out the life of Jesus Christ, than walking in the glory of the Holy Ghost? You quit hanging on to your life. You listen to me, and you'll find heaven. You get rid of the leaven, and you're going to find heaven. You're going to find glory. You won't live around and all that. Those things where you touched by and impressed by and moved by the spirit of the world. There's people more moved, sometimes more moved by what mom and daddy has to say than what God has to say. More moved about what people around them have to say, and they get counsel. Blessed is the man who walked not in the counsel of the ungodly. And I just tell you right now, you go to the ungodly for counsel and you let them be the ones who impact your decision, and I'm telling you right now, you're not going to be blessed. You're just not going to be blessed. Because the reality of it is you're telling God by your action that the counsel of the ungodly, the counsel of the wicked, the counsel of mere men is more valuable and more meaningful to you than his counsel. Oh, dear people, it's time that we go ahead and begin to take a hold of the weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal but mighty. It's time that we begin to understand that we're supposed to deal with these thoughts that oppose the knowledge of Jesus Christ, which really it just effectively opposes the knowledge of the Word of God. Hallelujah. I was hearing some, and I've heard this before from others and have certain experiences in these things myself, where, you know, you people go out and they pray for hundreds of people and nobody gets healed, and they stand there just standing big in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ because they bought all in and nothing really happened supernatural, but they didn't stop. And then one day, because they just went ahead, and no matter what trial, no matter what event, no matter what opposition, no matter what testimony that would come out against them and say that the things of the Word wasn't valid in their life, they didn't stop. And then all of a sudden they stepped into explosive power demonstration of God. They were just willing to be that sold out. They were just willing to give everything in to that realm in which they had now trusted their soul when they called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and was made a new creation and filled with the very presence of the Son. Hallelujah. It's about time God people get some boldness. I mean, I'm telling you right now. Come on, folks. Amen. You know it's a terrible thing to inherit an army of cowards. Huh? People don't know how to mount the horse. You ever seen any of those old cavalry movies, you know, where the sergeant comes and the place is just completely a mess, and because there's been no discipline, and then, you know, it tells everybody to mount. Nobody can get on the horse. The horses are bucking and running all over the place. You know, people don't even know which end of the gun it shoots the bullet, and it's just really crazy stuff. Sometimes I think about that kind of looks like the army of God. Because they've never given themselves to those weapons of our warfare. Many of God's people have never fully engaged into all that heaven has supplied, because they've lived after what they've seen. They've lived after a natural world. They've been consecrated to live the life that they inherited through mommy and daddy. They're consecrated to live the life that they got because they were born in the United States of America, instead of being consecrated to live the life that you were born into when you were born by the Spirit of the living God, to step over into a heavenly realm and live by the Holy Ghost now. And to seize it for all that God has supplied it to be. To seize it for all that the Word has described it to be, proclaimed it to be. To stand up tall, recognizing that He's filled us with all that He has. No matter who we are, people walk around with a mentality of various different sorts and types. Listen, the Lord wants to give us an understanding. He wants to give us a mind and a means to think about ourselves in terms of Almighty God living on the inside of us, being those who have been created anew in righteousness and true holiness, those who are one with Him and seated together with Him, those who have received His glory and have been trusted with His power and His authority, the sonship ministry of those who do these works and greater works, that which all creation groans and travails to see, the sonship ministry, those who are led by the Holy Ghost. I don't see any breaks. I don't see any dispensational breaks in Romans chapter 8. I just hear God talking about those who are born of the Spirit and who have become a new creature, and by virtue of having received this miracle gift of salvation, have become the sons of the Almighty. Hallelujah. To be consecrated, to be set apart, to be set apart to living by the Holy Ghost. Why back and forth? Why continual backsliding? Why continual halting between two opinions? Why not just sell out and just go ahead and live by the Holy Ghost? And understand that you begin to learn these things simply by the outworking of disposition, by saying, no, I'm not going to be unhappy and sad and sorrowful. I'm gonna put the joy on and scare it to death right now. Amen. Hallelujah. And the sorrow and sighing flee away when you get all, you know, beautified with salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When praise and just continually flood your soul, when you begin to understand the connection between Ephesians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19, and Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 and 11. The connection that redeem the times, for the days are evil. Don't be foolish, but be wise. Understand what the will of the Father is. Understand, that is a very important phrase. Understanding what is the will of the Father. Because the Lord said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is going to come in. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming in the kingdom. But those who do the will of the Father. The will of the Father is first and foremost. There's a lot of people say this and say that about how right they are with God. You need to get right according to the Word of God, not right according to your imaginations. Right according to what God said by cooperating with Him and earnestly hungering and thirsting to be what He's described us to be. And if you're not that, then you're crying out and screaming and saying, oh, God, help me. I mean, you know. I'm telling you, his eyes go to and fro looking for somebody who's doing that, who has that kind of hunger, who has that kind of commitment, who has that kind of passion. Yes. And I guarantee you, he'll mobilize all heaven for you when you have that response to him. He will. His prayers are open. His ears are open to the prayers of this church. Yes. Father delights in this church. Yes. Father delights in the people in this church, yes. No matter what age group you are spiritually. I just want everybody to start getting equipped and start living in the glory life. I want you to go ahead and start to cooperate with the Holy Ghost so we can see some manifestation of the Spirit of God in your life. People just want to do their own thing and then somehow come and let God now suddenly do his thing through them when they get in the meeting. Ain't going to happen. You're going to be dead as a doornail. You just be sitting there, can't respond to nothing. Why? Because you've yielded your emotions and your feelings and your appetites to all the things that the world would stimulate you with. And you become alive to the world and the circumstances and situation around you and become dead to the movings of God. And if not dead, numb. Numb, paralyzed, spiritually paralyzed. But here tonight, we're here to revive you. But we'd like to do more than just revive you every time we see you. You know why? It's CPR again. Here we go. Hallelujah. He was living on a deathbed experience in God. It's about time people start getting up and begin to run with the strength of the Lord and power of his might. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And you know, it's by praising God. It's by the word hallelujah, which means the hallel to Yehovah, the praise of thanksgiving to him. As you praise him and you give thanks to him, you're empowered. Don't be foolish. But understand what is the will of the Father. Don't be drunk with wine in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. And that is not only linguistically continually filled with the Spirit, but continually filled with the Spirit. Because he says, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now that's continual. Hallelujah. Why don't you do that? Why don't you learn how to dance a little bit? Why don't you learn how to live by the Word, walk in the Word? Why don't you learn to let the Word make your decision for you instead of sitting here trying to analyze it? What's wrong with you people? Why live as those that are in the dark who have no light? When the Word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. When the Word of God is the means by which we step into all the inheritance of God, where it is that which Father... Listen, I believe that so many people... have come into the kingdom of God. They've not been willing to be trained how to deal with temptation. You and I are going to be tempted. We are going to be tested. We're going to be tried. Let me just tell you what that means. You are going to be evaluated. And you better be equipped. And you better be fit to be evaluated. Otherwise, you're going to continually not overcome. Blessed is the man who, when he is tried, endures. Huh? Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for he shall receive a crown of life that fades not away. Instead of enduring, you're overwhelmed, you're overcome, you fail. It's about time to get equipped. God led them through the wilderness, through the trials and the temptation and the evaluation of the wilderness, that he may prove them. He may teach them. Man does not live by bread alone, but by the word, by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. When Jesus was being evaluated as a three-year-old lamb, if you would, although he was 30. He was being evaluated. And of course, man reaches his maturity at 30. The lamb reaches its maturity at 3. Being fully evaluated to see if there be any blemish in him. And then he was evaluated again 3 more years. But when he went up and was driven up into the wilderness by the Holy Ghost, listen to that. He was led up by the Holy Ghost. In one translation, you could say it that way. In fact, because I believe Matthew actually said it that way. But Mark said he was driven up into the wilderness, driven by the Holy Ghost, taken into a place to be evaluated. Look what he does. Huh? Said man, and Satan comes to tempt him. He just quotes the word of God. He's living by the word. He's not living by his appetite, his need, by the circumstance or situation around him. He's not living by some kind of challenges or intimidation. Satan's trying to intimidate him, if you be, if you are, if you really are. He said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. He knew exactly where he was. He knew exactly what the spiritual weapons of his warfare were. There's no power greater than the word of God. There's no power, no authority greater than the name of Jesus. If people just learn how to plaster the name of Jesus all over everything, they learn how to speak the name of Jesus over things in their life. They learn how to begin to move by the Holy Ghost, the same Holy Ghost that has come upon you and begin to have the utterance of the divine language. That same Holy Ghost will move you into a divine ability to properly respond and to deal with every situation of adversity. It's just that simple. It's not hard. It's a consecrated life. It's a life of sanctification. We've been sanctified, set apart unto holiness, something that is only defined by the very presence of God. And that isn't boring, because in his presence is fullness of joy. And at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Things that you can't even begin to understand till you step into the holies of holies, and then all of a sudden you're going to have a similar response to the seraphim. Hey? You talk about ecstasy, you talk about thrill, you talk about intensity, you talk about the life power of the... give me a break. People sitting around playing with their peanuts when God's giving you the riches of heaven. Huh? People sitting around counting their little coins, spending their life for that which does not profit. I mean, I was prophesying last night in the house. I'm crying out. I'm saying, honey, we got to get right with God. The Lord is coming. She's like, okay, baby. If you see anything, just tell me. I mean, I just could feel just such an intensity. It's the time. The time is at hand. We're about to stand before him. We're about to be evaluated by him. Our life is about to be brought into question and examination before a holy God. I don't just do that in church, actually. These things just come on me. They come on me driving down the road. They come on me in the night. I want people to come. I pray and cry out to God. Oh, Lord, let there be a communication of your spirit through my life, that men and women, boys and girls, can begin to have a spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of you, that can begin to have an encounter with the reality of who you are. The fact that they are on a road into eternity. And that they're spending their time for that which does not profit, which has no value and no meaning. I tell you, the worst thing I can imagine is to have all of my work tried and they be all burned up. And all I have at the end is saved by fire. I would be grateful just to be able to even to look afar upon his face. What a blessing. But I'm not doing that, man. I'm not going to do that when God has fully equipped us and made us able ministers of the new covenant. Hallelujah. Yes. Who's empowered us with such a relationship and such a walk where that we can have all these things that belong to bringing him honor and glory and living for his purpose. And I'm not even talking about living for yourself. Now, I'm not talking about that. Don't get confused. I'm talking about wood, stubble, and hay. And you thought you were, you know, living out your life in obedience to the Lord. I'm talking about people living their life for themselves. You better put God first. You better put the kingdom of God first. And it's going to be evaluated in your life. But the only real way that you know whether or not you're doing that is if you're listening to the Holy Ghost who wants to lead you and guide you and give you understanding. Otherwise, you just sleep. You sleep. You dream in. Wake up. And even worse, you could be blind by deception. Making decisions out of your own interest. It was a wonderful day when I stepped into a relationship with the Lord enough to know the difference between the Holy Ghost and me. You know, between my own self-interest, where I did things out of a self-serving, you know. And somebody asks you a question, and however, if it doesn't impact you, you may be given a more honest answer. If it impacts you, you're going to give them a self-serving one. Death is very easy to do. And if you don't know you've been doing that, now you know. Somebody said, right, can you be certain? I can. We all have the same parents. We all look alike and act alike. We have various different strengths and skills and whatnot, but nonetheless, we come from the same mom and dad, Adam and Chava, or Adam and Eve. Her Hebrew name is Chava, so I just like to say what her name is rather than go through several translations, you know. But everybody's, Chava, who's that? But the Lord tells us, be filled with the Spirit.
Yes. Yeah.
And you know when you really need to be most filled with the Spirit? When you recognize that you're least filled with the Spirit. Huh? Can you hear me right now? If you could just start recognizing at that moment, you'll start recognizing in the more subtle moments. Are you listening to me? Huh? Just stand back and ask yourself, now is that a fruit of the Spirit? Now is that an overflow of the river of God? Now is that the life of Christ Jesus being manifested in me right now? And then you just stop and don't feel all bad about yourself and paint the big old loser on your forehead and, you know, start beating yourself up, because those who are in Christ Jesus, there's no condemnation. And to even be able to stop and to contemplate that for a moment is a reality that can only be brought to you by the Holy Ghost. It's God constantly just subtly talking to you. And I mean, I believe that Father, God, the Holy Ghost has been walking around people for years saying, hey, could you listen to me just a second? And he just stays with us. He just stays with us and says, hey, could you just listen to me a second? And we're just pulling away from him, doing our own thing. Huh? And we get about 80 years old and suddenly feel the tug. Well, who's tugging on me? It's me. Well, what do you want? I would like you to allow me to bless you. I'd like for you to allow me to lead you. I'd like for you to allow me to strengthen and empower you. I'd like for you to allow me to supply you with all that Jesus purchased at Calvary and poured out when he ascended up on high. Let's not wait till 80. And that the sensitivity to begin to really yield our members is to the Holy Spirit, to the living God, for which we've been set apart. We entered into a covenant and was sanctified to live in the Holy Ghost. And the only way that we got sanctified and privileged and able and worthy to live in the Holy Ghost is because we were sprinkled by the blood of Jesus Christ and made pure by his blood, by the application of his life. And now we're going to choose to live our own life? Wake up. The Word of God is powerful and it's living. Do you know how powerful the Word of God is? Satan tries to keep people from giving themselves to the Word of God. Oh, it's spirit in its life. We just want to try to make it as stories and, you know, and we want to try to reduce it to verbs and nouns. Spirit, life. It's living and it's powerful. It quickens us. The entrance of his word quickens me, gives me life, it strengthens me. It's meat unto my being, my spiritual life. It's bread unto me. Oh. People don't have a good diet of fellowship in the Word of God. It's been too relegated to a religious thing. Thus, they're not fit for the evaluation. They're not fit for the temptation. They're not fit for the examination. Though, as Jesus said, though their spirit may be willing, their flesh is weak. Come now, he says, come, pray with me. So why? So that you don't enter into temptation. In other words, when you're evaluated and when you're tried, you don't fail because you're just so weak and lifeless and lifeless. Some of you need to go without food for a long time so that you can understand what I'm talking about, so that your senses may be enlightened to the reality of what you've been doing spiritually. Then Satan's able to come and occupy thoughts in your mind. He's able to the demon powers, the force of this world, the spirit of disobedience is able to actually be more aggressive about imposing things upon your consciousness and your thinking realm, but otherwise he wouldn't be able to get near you, man. He's able to impose upon you doubts where otherwise you'd be so full of faith, doubt couldn't even come and make a suggestion. God wants you to be so full of faith that doubts can't exist. But you got to learn to walk by the word. It's a decision you're making. It's very practical. It's something that you can apply continually. And you know, when the Lord sees you in that situation where you recognize, wait a minute, I'm not yielding myself to the Holy Ghost here. I'm not being filled with the Spirit right now. And you begin to now say, Lord, Holy Ghost, fill me. Hallelujah. And you begin to sing, hallelujah, and worship him, give thanks unto him. Because this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. In all things you give thanks. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, I only give thanks when I understand the situation. Well, you know what? You're not going to be giving thanks much because you don't really understand much. But if you could just give thanks and knowing that he's keeping you, yes, and that he's watching over you, and that he's leading you, and he's ordering your steps, that he'd never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. So long as you put your trust in him, so long as you want to have him in your life, so long as you want this relationship, so long as you want to grow, nothing can pluck you out of his hand.
That's right.
What an amazing God. Yes. What a faithful God. Oh, Rabba Sete Alehush. He's perfecting everything that concerns us. Hey, he who began a good work shall finish it. Amen. That's just too. Yes, having begun and won the Holy Ghost, you can now be made perfect by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if you just sit there and don't say nothing. I don't know if you're going to ever get anything. Huh? Don't sit down from here on in, don't sit down at the table and open up your mouth. Just sit there and just bring the spoon up to your mouth and sit back down. Some of you just so quiet. In this heaven, there's no response to heaven. And thus sickness will take over you, and thus sin will take over you, and thus plagues of mind and soul will take over you. Because you're not fit for the battle. You don't know the word that's supposed to be living on the inside of your heart, in your mouth, and the praise and the thanksgiving. Because if you can't participate with it in this atmosphere of divine glory, don't tell me you're participating with anything that's real anywhere. Because I'm telling you, I know better. I've been around longer than you have. Ha! I'm older in the Holy Ghost than you are. Ha! I'm more equipped than you are. Now listen up and participate. Start telling yourself what you're going to do and what you're not going to do rather than letting yourself tell you what you're going to do.
Hallelujah.
Huh? Start telling yourself based on the word of God and those things that the Spirit of the living God has said. You listen to me. I don't really even, people want to email me and text me and say they need to meet with me. Why? If your mouth is open unto God and you're eating the good food of the Spirit of the Lord and you're hungry and you're thirsty and you're responding to God, then I'm happy to meet with you. But if you're sitting there all dried up, go sit down the table and open up your mouth and take in the food, but yet in the realms of the Spirit, you sit there with the mouth closed, I'm just going to tell you, well, first thing and foremost, just start responding to God the Holy Ghost, because if he can't help you, I can't help you. You know, if you can't respond to him, how is it that you can respond to me? Are you listening to me? There's more going on to satisfy and meet your needs and give you direction right here in the context of the meeting place than there's ever going to be in a room of counseling. The room of counseling are for the wise. The room of counseling are for the submitted and the surrendered and the filled. The room of counseling aren't for those people who aren't filled and equipped by the Lord. All that is just another mess. You trying to convince me to agree with whatever your mind is saying. You hear me?
Yes.
That's what most counseling goes on. You're trying to convince me to agree with whatever it is you want. Huh? Give me a break. I'm not interested. I'm interested in teaching you how to be equipped to follow the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
How to receive that which God the Holy Ghost is supplying. You're going to have to interact with Him.
Yes.
You're going to have to be willing to allow the Spirit of the Lord to get you prepared in such a way to where you now are able to receive that life-giving authority and strengthening power of the Word of God. God, through His Word, created everything. We understand that the heavens were framed by the Word of God. We understand by faith that the heavens were framed by the Word of God. That's a lot of power. Why don't you start obeying God? You start obeying God and you start walking in the Holy Ghost. You start walking in the Holy Ghost, you're going to have the manifestation of the Holy Ghost in the church. They're sitting there looking like something. Pies and shit. Too many people sit around in the church looking like something poisoned them. They look like they poisoned. I'm here to give you the cure. Hallelujah. Pre-cut-us-sit-a. But you're going to have to open up your mouth. Because I've discovered and sensed not only throughout the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, everywhere the Lord has taken me, people don't know how to be filled with the Spirit in the church meeting. They don't know how to be filled with the Spirit speaking in themselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. When Paul said to the church of Colossians, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And he said basically the same thing. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly by speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, giving thanks unto the Lord. Huh? And he said to the church at Ephesus, be filled with the Spirit by speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And people sit around looking all frowny. You tell me that's an expression of the Holy Ghost, looking all sorrowful and sad. Don't give me a break. That's an expression of you. That's where you said no to the Holy Ghost. You're listening to me. We say no to the Holy Spirit, not verbally, but by our action and by our behavior, because we hold on to those things which are unholy. Unholy thoughts, self-interest, overwhelmed by circumstance and situation. I want to show you how to live sin-free, but you got to be willing to be taught. I'm being taught by the Lord. I want to show you how to live disease-free, but you got to be willing to be taught. I want to show you how to live blessed, financially blessed. That also get him on, Jason. Something poisons you. Words will poison you. Lies will poison you. Huh? Opinions of men will poison you. You'll be sick. And not even able to respond to that which God would give you the ability, supernatural ability. But I mean, I want to talk to those who are wanting to moving on instead of having to get stuck looking at people that are completely offline. I don't like leaving anybody behind. But I look at everybody. You know, if I'm in a crusade and I'm preaching in a crusade and it's just thousands of people, I'm just going to preach and declare a word of God for the single purpose of seeing people saved, healed, and delivered. But when I'm pastoring, when I'm ministering in context of the church, I'm not only wanting to bring the word of God that He's laid upon my heart that would cause the church to grow and to be strengthened and to begin to move in a greater dimension of authority, but I begin to deal with everybody in that context, everybody based on their individual needs. And when I see the spirit of rebellion, or if I see the spirit of obstinance and stubbornness, man, that's such the pride of life. That is as bad. Look, the pride of life is as bad as the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. And the thing about it is, there's people who, they basically, boy, they read their Bibles and they pray and they're just religious. It has nothing to do with the life-giving power of God. They have no increase. There's no flow of the Spirit. There's no supply of the Spirit. There's no response to the Holy Ghost. And they're on their way to hell just like anybody else is on their way to hell. They need to learn how to repent and come into the Lord Jesus Christ and submit themselves to the Word of God and the Spirit of God. Somebody say, you want people to be submitted to you? No, I want anybody to be submitted to me. I want you to be submitted to the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And then if you submit to the Word of God and the Spirit of God, you're going to be submitted to the anointing and wherever anybody's teaching the Word of God and the Spirit of God. I don't want you to hold men's person in admiration. I ain't doing any good. I want you to hold the head in his proper place so that the things that come down from Jesus, that come down out of the realms of the kingdom of God, may be able to flow into you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it becomes apparent. I'll show you people growing in the Holy Ghost, people who the Word of God is not being, ineffective in their life, because the manifestation of the Spirit of signs and wonders and miracles and cooperation with the Holy Ghost is continuing on to increase. Instead of they're just stuck. And we think that they're having revival when they smile. And I've watched many people in the whole meeting, they frown the whole time. In the meeting, they all get happy. Boy, they become real talkative, interactive with people. And I think, Father, please forgive them. They do not know what they do. They don't know that they gave you the cold shoulder the whole meeting, and now they're turning their affections towards men and delighting in the conversation with men. They don't delight in you. Father, forgive them. They just don't know what they're doing because they're just ignorant. They're blinded by their own self-interest. And I tell you that so that you'll stop it right now, not so that you'll continue doing it. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Of course, the people who don't need to listen at all concerning that because they're doing it, they are excited about listening. And the people who needed to respond said nothing. Once again, they're just nothing. Nothing came out of their mouth. They just sit there, zombie-like, with stitches across their lips. Jesus, I want you to be healed right now. I would like to go on with the meeting. I just didn't know that these several demons were going to come. I wasn't prepared for them. I wasn't prepared. But I'm going to run them off.
Yeah.
I'm going to insult them till they leave.
Hallelujah.
It's my tactic. I just insult the devil till he gets mad and manifest. Amen. Hallelujah. Sabakari shiyaramateyara. Why? People, it's time that we begin to understand what God has supplied us with so that we can ultimately be a part of what he's purposed us to do. You're not going to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might if you're not being filled with the Spirit. You're not. Being strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might is a direct result of being filled with the Spirit. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Samson was as weak as any other men. But in the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Hallelujah. Then he was given an equipped ability, a supernatural ability by God to stand against all the forces that could possibly be raised up against him.
Yeah.
He was became a deliverer to Israel. Hallelujah. And that's, we read in Obadiah chapter 1:21 that God would raise up in these days of salvation, it's not millennial reign days, but in the days of salvation, he would raise up deliverers against Edom, which stands for the world. Hallelujah. Because somebody has been willing to be filled with the Spirit. When the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, he became stronger than any whole army. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I just tell you right now, Goliath did not have a snowball's chance in hell against David. Because no one else understood it, but David, he had a relationship with the Lord enough to know when the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Why? Because the Spirit of the Lord would come upon him and he would begin to prophesy. He'd begin to what to do? Sing psalms and hymns, spiritual songs. He would. Now, he didn't do the spiritual songs because that was left for the New Covenant age and New Covenant time. Spiritual songs are songs with the utterance out of the divine language. But he began to sing psalms and hymns. And he wrote many. And he was there in that place where when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, there's no fear or intimidation. There's so much boldness. You're not threatened by the lion or the bear. You're going to kill him. You're going to kill them. You're going to take them down right then, right there. All of a sudden, the way that men think, the way that they respond to that which is seen, you don't respond in the same way. You respond totally different. You grab them by the beard and slay them. Barehanded, as it were. You know, I love just looking at all the mighty men of David and the things that they were able to do. Not one of them fell prey to death. Not one of them could be defeated. Not one was defeated except for the one that was betrayed by David himself, Uriah the Hittite. Oh, people, we mightier today. The strength of the Lord and the power of his might, but we're going to have to be willing to be filled with the Spirit. We're going to have to understand that that is a living relationship. And the more that you live in that relationship, the more you're sensitive to that wonderful realm of God, the more you're able to receive that which he's supplying. Hallelujah. You know, and that really needs to be your life. You need to be excited about the things of the Spirit, because if you can't be, there's no way that in adversity you can begin to sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and make melody in your heart. You'll be running scared. You'll be more silent than ever before. You know, when you stress out, you quit breathing. When you get afraid, literally you do. Your breathing slows way down. You're like holding your breath. You don't recognize it. But it's true. Physiologically, you stop breathing. You start holding your breath. We want you to understand that God has delivered you from the bondage of fear. We want you to understand he's given you a glorious liberty now to live in the things of the Spirit. To live in the supply of heaven. Hallelujah. So that now you are then fit. And being filled with the Spirit, speaking yourself, psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, sing and make a melody. Guess what you can do? You can deal with principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness.
Amen.
Effectively.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
As effectively as David dealt with Goliath.
Yeah.
As effectively as Samson dealt with the Philistines. And on the judges and all the men of the Spirit that we can talk about, everybody you read about in the Old Testament that was used of God, They did those things because they were strengthened by the Holy Ghost. They were strengthened by the Spirit. As for me, I believe that for most people, it certainly was for them, it certainly is for me, that once the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the fire of God's come upon you, you love it. You won't live without it. People who just were willing to live without it in the meeting like this, Kelly, they've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. They've never been touched by the fire. Fire's never been in their life. Tonight, God wants the Holy Ghost and fire to come upon your life. Tonight, the Spirit of the Lord wants to find a place of freedom to flow through you. But he's not going to force you. God's not going to do something that is outside of the realms of hunger and thirst. That is the greatest display of participation. That is the greatest display of need. Hunger and thirst, greatest, deepest, most longing, most intense passions known to men. Have you ever tried to go a long period of time without water? I have. I've experimented. Seeing what is it like to really be thirsty. Because I hear the Lord describe what it means to be thirsty spiritually. Thirsty in the Old Testament, and it is intense. It's intense. It's like he's describing a physiological state where you basically, your kidneys are about to fail you. You're so thirsty, your tongue's swollen up in your mouth. He said, you get thirsty like that and you begin to think. Because see, God wants truth. He doesn't want fake stuff. God wants truth. He demands truth in the inward parts. In the hidden parts, he makes us to know wisdom. Huh? Father's not looking for insincerity. He's looking for sincerity. Somebody who's been, who's been touched by the presence of the Lord. And I want you to understand, the grace of God has appeared to all men. The Holy Ghost is drawing all men. Father is drawing all men. Right now, the work of grace is immense upon the lives of people everywhere. The Spirit of the Lord has been poured out upon all flesh. It's just not everybody's responding to God. But we begin to take that impact of the Lord upon our life that we've responded to. And we begin to allow a hunger and a thirst, an appetite to be developed in our lives because we want more of this. I want more of you, Lord. I want more of the things that your word describes. I want more of the realms of heaven in my life. I want more of the active flowing of the Holy Ghost through me, where it comes for like a force, like rivers, where it overwhelms me, where I don't have to even run up against a situation where I take charge because I'm so overwhelmed continually by your charge and by your presence. He said, you get thirsty for me like that, and I'm going to open up heaven. I'm going to pour out more than you can contain. I'm floods, floods of heaven. Floods. Floods overwhelm you. You're going to be evaluated. You're going to be examined. Today, the church is very Laodicean. Today, the church is lukewarm and backslidden. And they think that they have everything, but they're blind and they're naked and they're miserable. And they're wretched. And the Lord's counseling them to come and buy gold tried in the fire. Come and get white raiment that they be without spot. I'm going to tell you, a Holy Ghost church on fire, filled up with everything that Jesus died, rose again, ascended up on high. Looks like the church that we read about in the book of Acts. There's no other model for the church of Jesus Christ. There's no other model for the church than what you see within the context of the church at Corinth. Because more the dynamics of just a startup church, a baby church, not a mature church, a startup church. The dynamics of the startup church is there with everything from wrongdoings going on, sin going on, misunderstanding of the operation of gifts, the full-blown activity of the glory of God being manifested in the place. And everybody's hungry, and everybody wants to participate. Hallelujah. You want to be ready to deal with the examination and the evaluation? Because you're going to be examined, and you're going to be evaluated. And you're going to have to learn how to enter into a realm of prayer. There's not some religious activity, some vain repetition, but a place where you begin to pray with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Huh? Praying with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. That's what Paul said in Ephesians 6:18. But Jude said, build up yourself. Get strong. Get strong. Get strengthened. Get empowered. What kind of strong? What kind of power? Strength of the Lord and power of his might. Build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Ultimately will then not only be prayer in the spirit, but it will excel into prayer with your understanding also. And now it won't just be prayers of the mental assent and prayers of the mind and prayers, well, I'm trying to figure out what it is I should pray. And it's just lifeless and it just sounds like tinkling cymbals, sound of breast. And you're like, well, I hope they hurry up and be quiet pretty soon. Kind of attitude in response, because it's not the presence of the living God that fills you. See, some people are satisfied with anything. I'm only satisfied with one thing, and that's the movings of the living God. I'm not interested in man. Nothing about man, whether man is being expressed through me or anyone else, has that value to me or interest to me. Why? I've been spoiled. I've been touched by the Holy Ghost. I've been in his presence, and it's overwhelming, and it's glorious, and it's joy unspeakable and full of glory, and it's, his pleasures forevermore, and I want those things. To be built up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. Fear don't have a chance. Fear doesn't have a chance when you're there in the love of God. You know, to dwell in the love of God, John said, when you dwell in the love of God, if you dwell in love, you dwell in God. Look, these things don't have a chance to come get you when you're dwelling in God. I mean, you bury it right down the big middle of the Father, Son, the Holy Ghost, and the Holies of Holies. What chance does the devil have? He can't even come in there. He can't even come in there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Woo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This isn't a fairy tale. This is the life. I don't care what any, I don't care what some backslidden preacher, some backslidden church, some lukewarm, you know, Laodicean church gave you an example of what Christianity is. Christ Jesus is the only example of Christianity. The outpouring of the Holy Ghost and a baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire is the express will of the Father. It doesn't matter about your doctrine, the denomination said. Religion is religion. Religion is never going to fill you with the life and the power and the glory of God. But I'm going to tell you right now, the Spirit of the Lord has made us well, has well fit us for the battle.
Amen.
Father has well established us and equipped us to be able to deal with every opposing force of darkness in every way that it presents itself. Insomuch he said that we would tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing should by any means hurt us. It's just that we've not understood how to function in him and walk with him and yield our members to him and allow him to feel our emotions and our passions and our appetite. We're so filled with the lust of the flesh, not me. The lust of the eye and the pride of life, not me. But people are who've not been willing to surrender their life to the Lord. And that's why they're overcome by the devil. And that's why they, you know, people say, oh, well, we got to sin more or less every day. We know what Peter said about that? He said, they are evil generation having eyes full of adultery who cannot cease from sin. That ain't me. I've overcome the wicked one because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I'm in a different classification. I have Christ Jesus living in me. This is the overcoming power that has overcome the world, even our faith. Hello. People want to make all of these various different things to be the qualifiers that you've been born again. But God makes the qualifiers that you've been born again, that you're walking in the Holy Ghost, that you're being led by the Holy Ghost, that you overcome the world. God makes the qualifier that you've been born of the Word and born of the Spirit because the Word abides in you and you have defeated Satan or conquered him at every point. His Word abides in you and you do not sin. I mean, that's where Paul took it. I mean, forgive me, John took it by John, 1 John 3:9. His seed remains in you and you will not sin. See, here's manifest the children of God and the children of the devil. He that doeth righteousness is of God, he that sinneth is of the devil. I mean, nothing could be more plain. But people in a Laodicean age, in a religious a stronghold age, they got their ears plugged up and they're screaming and hollering and saying, away with such a person, for it's not right they should live. Because religion wants to justify itself and be right in its own eyes rather than being justified by the Lord and being right in the eyes of God. I'm going to humble myself before the throne of grace and I'm going to say, oh God, take this life, change me. I want to be what you want me to be. I am going to conform to his image. I am going to conform to his will. It's my decision. I will either conform to the world or I will conform to the word. I will conform to the ways of men or I will conform to the image of Christ Jesus. It's a decision that God leaves it for us to decide upon on a day-to-day basis. And praise God, because of his grace and because of his own good pleasure, he's equipped us with a divine ability that if we choose him, he comes with all the force of heaven to establish us and to equip us and to strengthen us and to enable us so that we will not fail. We won't, listen, we won't even stumble. That's why Peter said, make your calling and election sure, because if you do these things, you will not even stumble. I know King James translated it, you will not fall, but it's literally stumble, because the two Greek words were already established in Romans chapter 9 and 10. Israel stumbled that they should not fall. And there's two different words already defined for us in Scripture. We don't have to guess at this. Literally, the word that is used there in 2 Peter chapter 1 is, you will not even stumble. Woo! Hey, when you as hungry as I am about being right with God and being found in Christ Jesus, that's good news. I want to be accepted in every way. I want to be found in him. Hallelujah. I'm not playing Russian roulette with my soul. You and I are walking out a walk right now into eternity. And you better do it God's way, because it's the only way that is acceptable unto Him. People say, oh, I've just had the Lord with me all my life. He's been right there. Not if you've been walking in unrighteousness. Not if you've been walking in unholiness. Not if you've been walking in impurity, because He will have no fellowship with you. He's made it very clear. In fact, He told me, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. If any man calls himself a brother, and he gives himself to drinking alcohol and gives himself to immorality, don't even so much as eat with him. And then people are going to say that Father's going to be with him. He's not. There will always be an open door of opportunity. There will always be the Lord standing at the door of your heart, knocking, wanting to fellowship with you, but there'll be no fellowship. And you can pretend and make believe all you want that Jesus is on your side. You're going to wake up in a place called hell in torment that has no reprieve. It lasts forever. It's a prison of everyone who enjoyed living in sin and practicing it. It's those who enjoyed living in this world. It's for the defiant. Was Korah and his band so evil? No, they were just defiant. And in their defiance against what God was doing, they went down into hell alive. They didn't die until they hit the flames of hell. The earth opened up and swallowed them. That's what defiance and rebellion does for people. And that stronghold of demon power has ruined the church. That is the wicked thing that works in churches all over America that has made us ineffective, that has ultimately brought us to ruin. And that's why I am so passionate against it. And when I see it manifested on people's face, all I want to do is tear the thing completely apart. I will not accommodate it. It is the demon power. It is the strategy of Satan that has stopped the glorious church from being the glorious church. And I would hate to think that I allowed such a ruinous thing to work through my spirit. If I thought for a moment, I'd tell you right now, I'd be down on the ground screaming, crying out God for mercy, weeping and pleading. Oh God, let not this thing, you know, have any more place in my life. Listen, and today, if you're here in this place, and you do not have the ability to respond to God, it may mean that you're possessed by a demon spirit. Or you're severely oppressed. Because when you're severely oppressed or possessed by the devil, you don't have a will anymore. You're being smothered by the power and activity of an unholy thing. God wants to deliver you. Hallelujah. He wants to set you free. But you have to be willing. Yeah, no, dear people, I want you to understand. Don't allow this to be applying to you if it doesn't apply. Because there's people here in serious need. If you've been responding in the meeting, you participate in the meeting, you know I'm not talking about you. Huh? If you're hungry and thirsty for the things of God and you're growing, maturing in the things of the Spirit, I'm not talking to you. And one of the most important things that people understand, one of the strategies that Satan uses against people all the time is condemnation. Those who are in Christ Jesus. And you know, condemnation comes out of fear. Did you know condemnation is actually the opposite of peace? Huh? They that are in Christ Jesus, there's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus who do not walk after the flesh or human ability anymore or are unredeemed nature, but after the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord, redeemed by the Spirit of God, made a new creation, born of the Spirit, having now been made partakers of the divine nature and escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I've escaped. I once was in prison. He came, broke me out. Hallelujah. And I am rejoicing all the day long. Hallelujah. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessed peace, what a fellowship. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, what a blessed with my Lord so near. Leaning. Listen, I mean, I just love the beauty of that song here. The peace, the fellowship, the blessedness, the Lord so near. Ooh. Why? Because I find myself constantly looking unto Him, the author and finisher of my faith. I find myself constantly leaning on Him, depending upon Him, resting upon Him, looking unto Him. As I have received Christ Jesus, so I'm going to walk in him. I'm going to live in him because he lives in me. I'm going to have a river of life that flows so free. I'm going to have a wellspring springing so I'm never thirsty for the things of this world, but filled up with heaven continually. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I praise the Lord for the abiding place. The abiding place being a church where we are consecrated to abiding in Christ Jesus. Consecrated to living out the abundant life, which is the God life, which is a joyful life, which is a life full of love and peace, which is a life full of the Holy Ghost. I want you to be able to say that you do more than just go to the abiding place. I want you to say that you live in the abiding place. You are part of the abiding place. And I'm not just talking about a local church that has been named by God to be that. Hallelujah. But I'm talking about your response to Jesus' invitation in John chapter 15. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One time I thought, well, we ought to maybe change the name, be a little more contemporary, you know. Whatever. Be a little more whatever, you know. And the Spirit of the Lord said, don't you dare.
Yeah, I did too.
You didn't name it. You didn't name that church. You didn't name the church. I named the church. I'm going to hold up before you what my will is. Jesus said, I come to declare the will of the Father. I come to make known the will of the Father. He declared to us his will. He said, come and abide in me. If you're not going to abide in him, live out your life in him. If you're not going to be willing to accept this life in him. I mean, people, I'm telling you, fear and condemnation and intimidation and circumstances and situation and life events is doing everything it possibly can, and demon powers are doing everything they possibly can for you to keep you from feeling like you can live and dwell and have your whole life and existence and meaning and person in him, and purpose in him. But it's not true. And there's an invitation. He said, just come live in me. Come dwell with me. Just come. If my word abides in you. If you dwell in me and my word abides in you, you ask whatever you will. You ask whatever you will, Father's going to do it. It's going to be yours. You talk about being fit for the examination. I'm fit for the examination. Why? Because I've learned in the moments of examination, the moments of trial, and the moments of adversity, to cry out to Father. I don't just take it as a casual event and choices of things that are going on and decisions and possibilities and opportunities in this life. I'm in a battle. I'm in a war. I'm in a conflict against those things that are opposed to the life and the glory of Christ Jesus being made manifest in my life personally and also in the church. So I look unto him and allow the Spirit of the Lord to come upon me. I'm not going to go face Goliath on my own. I'm not going to go face Goliath being all in a bad mood and feeling all, you know, worn down. Huh? No, sir. Lord. And you know what? Here's the beautiful thing. As we begin to, in our life, in a relationship with the Lord Jesus, with voluntarily just crying out to him and yielding ourselves to him, we find ourselves maturing and growing to a place in God where it's as though we've already... It's like the permission is already given. Now it's just, it's like it's already established, and the Spirit of the Lord comes upon us before we even know that we're now facing a temptation. So I wake up in the morning, as it were, and the Lord's already strengthening me and preparing me to deal with the things that I'm going to face of the day.
Yeah, that's right.
Hallelujah. And I run to his word because I'm hungry. I run to his word, not religiously, but out of relationship because there's spirit and life there. I run to his word because there's power there. I run to his word because there's quickening there. There's a life quickening power. Just like there's a life quickening power, strengthening power when you're touched by the Holy Ghost and filled with the Spirit, so the word so empowers us, so sets our heart and our mind aright, so sets our focus and our emotions and the things that we desire aright. It sets our sets all the things in order within the realm and the framework of our lives. We're fit. We're ready. Hallelujah. We yielded to him. We're saying to devils and men. We're saying to all the forces that are about us. We want God. We want his realm, his dominion. We want all that he has purposed us to have and be when he created us in Christ Jesus. Fit for the temptation. Fit for the examination. Fit for the battle. Fit for the trial. Equipped by the power of God. I write unto you, young men, because the word of God abides in you. To understand this word of faith that is in our hearts and in our mouth. To understand the way that the Lord has placed us in respect to this communion and fellowship with him when he filled us with his Holy Spirit. When he supplied to us an unlimited supply of heaven. Oh, Siridan Jesikushti. I want to read these couple of verses of scriptures to you real quickly. Ha, Tabaranaya. Ha, Sataradeshte. Melenge. Ramos. Hallelujah. I looked over at Chrissy up on the platform. I saw a spirit of the Lord come upon her and she started dancing. Boom, I got hit with it, man. I tell you. You know, really, that's the way it's supposed to happen in the body of Christ. As people begin to respond to the anointing, it just kind of like hits us and it just begins to excel. You know, I don't want to use the word play off of itself, but it serves the interests of God, the Holy Ghost, and spreads like a fire. We want you to be able to respond to the Holy Ghost. You got to be alive unto God to respond to the Holy Ghost. You got to understand how to shut down. Listen, you got to understand how to shut down improper effects, inappropriate and improper affections that would try to play in your emotions. If you're allowing unholy emotions to play in your emotions, it will hold you a prisoner against those things that God would have operating and function in your emotions. So offense will do it. There's a long list. Condemnation will do it. Shame will do it. Guilt will do it. Intimidation will do it. Unforgiveness will do it. You know, wouldn't it be a terrible thing that if you lived out your whole life held in the prison of a lie, that you believed something that never even happened, it was just an imagination, you get there on that day, and you lived in bondage to something that never even took place that happened that you believed happened. And all the time, it never happened. And you're going, you're saying to the Lord, you mean that didn't even happen? And it didn't even happen. You mean I lived my whole life in unforgiveness over something that didn't happen? I heard a guy tell about how that he stole a watermelon from a man's watermelon patch. And the man who he stole, a man had a watermelon stole from his watermelon patch. And he believed that this particular individual was the one who stole the watermelon. But this individual did not steal the watermelon. And it took years and several hundred years later, no, it wasn't 700 years later, but many, many years later, he's living in this unforgiveness and this terrible complaint of how could this person do such a thing to him? Prize watermelon. Can you imagine missing heaven over a watermelon in the first place? And then second of all, not only missing heaven over a watermelon, living in the prison of unforgiveness over a watermelon, but now you've created in your imagination that a person did it and they didn't even do it. And it wouldn't have even been a big deal to you if someone else had stolen the watermelon, but because this person and his relationship with you, what a lie. Could you imagine that the things that you're in prison to right now is just about as significant? Can you imagine? That it's just about as significant. Yep. It's just about as meaningful. Somebody stole my watermelon. They took my prize watermelon. Jesus help us. Jesus help us. The Holy Spirit is constantly describing to us what our disposition is. Forgiveness. Love, mercy. Hallelujah. Constantly describing our disposition. Joy, peace. Did you know that you were born again? You're bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. for the sole purpose of being set apart to live the rest of your existence in God the Holy Ghost. That you no longer have to live in demon power and under demon influence. Tonight, wouldn't it be easy for everybody in this place to accept a call to God to now be sanctified, set apart, to living out your life in God? To living out your life in the Holy Ghost? Does that seem hard? Does that seem harsh? Does that seem like a dull existence? Does that seem like something that's just impossible to do? Well, even if it did seem like it was impossible to do, the Lord would look at you and say, is anything too hard for me? And actually, when he was talking to Abraham and Sarah there, you know, in Genesis chapter 18, you know, and Sarah's an old lady, and her womb is all dried up. She's past that time. She doesn't even have that cycle of life anymore. And Abraham's an old guy. And when Scripture says that Abraham lifted up his eyes and he saw Yehovah coming to him. He named him by his name, Yehovah. That's what the Scripture says. It doesn't say, and he lifted up his eyes and saw the Lord coming. That's what the translation says. The Hebrew language says he lifted up his eyes and he saw Yehovah coming to him. God Almighty, the Father, that's Father's name. He saw Father. He said, you come here, you sit down now. Let me get yourself some, you wash here some water. Here's some water to wash your feet. Let me go get some bread. Let me get some milk. Let me get some food for you. You can sit here and comfort you yourself. And they said, do as you will. And they said, went from Yehovah to, and they said, do as you will. They spoke with one mouth, with one voice. There's many beautiful things to behold in the Word of God if you give yourself to it. Of course, you got to break free from the prison of men's doctrine and religious ideas. Many people believe nothing more than Greek philosophy. And I could go down the list of so much Greek philosophy that people believe and ascribe to, and they say that it's in the Word of God, and if I hold them to account to it, I say, you show me where it's in the Word of God, they'd not be able to find one place. But yet it's basically tenets and principles of modern-day Christian theology. That's another subject. But I'm touching on one of them right now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And he went and found a nice little fatted calf. He said, take this and dress it. And Sarah, hurry up. Take 3 measures of meal and knead it together and make some of that fine bread you make. He brought it and set it before them. And immediately the Lord said, where's Sarah? She's in the tent. He said, I shall return unto her. She shall have a child. And Sarah laughed. Should I have pleasure now in my old age when I'm beyond the time? And the Lord says, what'd Sarah laugh? Is anything too hard for me? Literally, Yehovah says, is anything too difficult for my word? I spent a lot of time hovering over this verse of Scripture trying to translate it because it is a very difficult phrase to translate. There's 3 words that literally says, is anything too difficult for Yehovah's word? Whew. I'm going to live by Yehovah's word. I'm going to live by the Father. Nothing's too difficult for him. Nothing. No miracle. Nothing that you have need of, nothing that you're facing or that you're challenged with is too difficult for him. He's come to bless you. He's come to give you an inheritance. He's come to give you a promise. He's come to establish his word in your life. You know what you have to do? You have to be done with yours. Because as long as you're holding on to your life, you can't have his. As long as you're rationalizing, well, I just don't feel, whatever. You don't have nothing. You have to surrender. You have to go die on a cross. You don't want to die on a cross, you can't have this. Huh? Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. You're going to have to be, this is the beginning of salvation. You go die on a cross. Hallelujah.
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 Did you know, do you know where Jesus defeated sin? On the cross.
Yeah.
On the cross.
Yeah.
Are you fit for the battle?
Yeah.
Are you equipped for the battle?
Yeah.
You're going to have to understand who you are and where you live and what your person is and what your ability is and what's your inheritance and what you're gifted with and what your resources are. To recognize as sons of the living God, we're heirs of God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hallelujah. And that's the way to grab it right there. I'm going to tell you right now. You hear the word of God, you begin to grab it by the Holy Ghost. It's yours. I'm telling you, it is yours. If there's anything people want to understand and do is how to respond to the word of God. Hallelujah. You don't want to be silenced because silence is rejection. It's rejection. Don't be silent. It's rejection. You say, well, I don't agree with you. Well, who are you to not agree with me? Huh? Especially if I'm standing in the place of the Lord and declaring his word to you. And it's that in that place that Moses said, well, then go get your censers. If you know better and you know how, then go get your censers. Oh, well, we still also are anointed of the Lord. Then go get your censer. Well, let's come and see what Papa's chosen. Huh? Oh, the Lord wants you to be broken. I'm going to labor with you. I'll stop and I'll labor with you. Those of you who will not respond to God, I'll stop and labor with you. I'm not talking about people who don't know him better. I'm talking about people who should know better. Just yield yourself. Just be broken right now. Just be broken. Just yield yourself to the Lord. Quit being stubborn. Quit looking off into the distance as though I'm not talking to you. Obey. That's a tough thing, isn't it? Somebody said he's harsh. I'm not harsh. I'm full of the love of Father that's not willing to stand around and watch you go to hell.
Hallelujah.
I'm full of the love of God that's not willing to stand around and watch you be miss out on all the blessings of God and live a sin-cursed life. Live under the stronghold of demonic powers. When you could have been a very important, effective part of the body of Christ. When Jesus went to great pains to bring you into the kingdom. I'm not going to act like you insignificant. Say, I don't pay attention to them. They don't count anyways. Huh? That ain't no value. That ain't no meaning. No. Every life is great value. Every life has great meaning. Father and his love come bust us out of prison. And gave his life to bust us out of prison. And everybody who's been anointed by him does the same thing. Hallelujah. And I believe that it needs to be in the church. And I believe God people need to understand that if you've been born again, the meeting should not have to be a wrestling match to try to get you to respond to the Holy Ghost, because then that just disrupts everything that God the Holy Spirit wanted to do for those people who maybe didn't even know the Lord. And now the whole meeting has got to be distracted because you won't respond to God. And now you're going to be held in the responsibility. You're going to give an account before God and held responsible for that. You better understand where you're at. You better start living your life before the judgment seat of Christ. You better quit playing pretend Christianity. Yeah. And get over the poor me's and a wish I had's. And somebody did me wrong. Get over here in the love of God.
Amen.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. It don't matter who done you wrong. Hallelujah. You just love them more, not less. You happy about the situation. Amen. Because you're blessed. You're living over here in glory land. You're living over here filled with the Spirit of the Lord. There's always an opportunity. The Lord never quits dealing with a man until he breathes out his last breath. When God's done dealing with you, you're not alive anymore. Somebody says, well, I've committed the unpardonable sin and this and that. Well, then you're dead. You, it's amazing that you're even here because you're over. It's done with you. No, so as long as you're alive, God's going to deal with you. And he's saying there is a sin offering that lies at your door. Offer it. If you've got a fallen countenance, sad countenance, why is your countenance fallen? That's Cain. I'm not going to look like Cain. Do I look like Cain? Why is your countenance fallen? There is a sin offering that crouches at your door. It is there. It's an opportunity. Come and offer it. You'd be accepted. And he didn't want to simply do what God the Father said. His father preaching the sermon. It's the proof right there that men, when they come and get into a certain state of stubbornness, they won't even respond, even if it's God himself that's the pastor and doing the preaching. And this is really what the Lord showed me a long time ago. He said, the way that they treat you is the way they treat me. The way they respond to you is the way they respond to me.
Yeah,
I had a friend of mine, Prophet Roger Gill. I said, Roger, I said, have you ever noticed, has God ever showed you that the way that people treat you is the way that he treats, the way that they treat him? And, you know, he was describing to me. First of all, he said, absolutely. And he was describing me thing after, one case after the other. And this is something that is common that the Lord has revealed to his servants, the prophets and those ministers of his. And people need to understand that. When you fall in love with Jesus, when you fall in love with the realms of the Holy Ghost, you will fall in love with the realms of the anointing. And it isn't the person, it's the anointing. I've seen some awkward looking funny people that in the natural, there is nothing about them to in any way be attracted to, but the anointing so powerfully on them, you just overwhelmed by what God is doing. Just to be in love with the anointing, to be in love with the Word of God, to be in love with the Spirit of God. Then you're not following men. People who have held men in admiration and followed men have over and again found themselves led astray. Oh, but when you follow the Word of God, then you hold the man accountable. Wait a minute, you just missed the Word of God there. Hold up. Hold everything. Ha. Wait a minute, you're not ministering out of the realms of the anointing. Where's that sweet presence of Jesus? Where is that glory of heaven? Hallelujah. I want those things back. You know, that we hold those things most dear and most sacred that God has given to us in the Holy Ghost. At a citizens of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I want you to listen to this, and I want you to let God make these things real to you.
Yes.
God has called you to live in sanctification. Listen, Jesus is our sanctification. He is our righteousness, and he is our redemption. But, hear me, if we do not live in him, we do not live in his life, none of those things are relevant to us. He is our sanctification. He is our righteousness and our redemption if we are in him. If we are dwelling in him. If we're living our life in him. If we're, as we have received Christ Jesus, even so we're walking in him. We're living out the life that he's filled us with, the abundant life. When he came into my heart, when he came into my life, when he took up residence on the inside of me so that I could say, he dwells in me. The greater one dwells in me. The mystery of the fellowship, Christ in me. You listen to me.
Amen.
Then he is my sanctification.
Hallelujah.
Then he is my righteousness. And he is my redemption. And then there is that inworking has an outworking. Yeah. So that now I participate with sanctification. I live out the life to be separated from all this world. I come out from among them. I don't touch the unclean thing. I don't touch the thing of sin and iniquity. Hallelujah. I give myself over to walking as an obedient child, not conforming or fashioning myself after the former lust that was in my life. But instead, I'm holy just like he's holy. Hallelujah. And that is only defined by living in that place that he lives in, separated from all things that don't belong to the realms of his life.
Yes.
That's the sanctification that we've been called into, that we've been given. We've been privileged. It's ours. It's a gift. We've been sanctified so that we might now give ourselves to sanctification, giving ourselves to saying, this is who I am. I'm separated to live this life, to be conformed to Christ Jesus, not conformed to the world.
Yes.
To be transfigured by thinking different.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I want to just read these verses of scripture to you real quick. I know I've been threatening to do it now for a while. Hallelujah. There's no reason that anybody here should walk out of this place and into an eternity without God. There's no reason that anybody should walk out of this place living out their life as they've lived it up to this point. I don't care how filled you are, God's got more. He's got all His fullness ready for you and me. And He made it available. You know, I've always been so captivated by this verse of Scripture in Ephesians chapter 3 that the Lord has given to you and I the privilege to know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know all the fullness of God. To know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and be filled with all the fullness of God. He's given us this capacity. Having been rooted and grounded and settled in love, we may comprehend with all the holy ones, all the saints, all the holy ones, all the sanctified ones, all the set apart ones to living out the life of God, which is the abundant life, which is the life of Jesus Christ, which is the life of the Holy Ghost, the life so filling us now. I don't mind. I can sit and I can stand and preach and minister with the most radical sinners and people who are so full of iniquity. And there's nothing but compassion and love. But when there are people who call themselves Christians and have justified themselves in their own mind, sitting in defiance to the Holy Ghost, there's a holy indignation that rises up inside of me. You know, I would never want to think that I was the object of God's holy wrath and indignation. I would never want to think that the Lord was leveling His complaint against me. And I'm telling you, there's one or two people in this place, you're going to have to stop it. You're going to have to bring it to a stop because you're in trouble. And I just let you know, you can't continue on the way you are because it's not men that you're messing with. Not just a religious thing. I know church has been religion for you for many years. These are the holy things of God. And you don't, God in His loving kindness and His mercy and His grace forbears. But there comes a point. You won't touch the holy things of God and not end up with some major chastening. And I don't like to see people. I've been here before. You listen to me. I've been here with many people, right where I'm with you right now. I've been here with many people. And I've warned people and I've told people, and it's come to a place where I've had to point people out, stand them up even. So you listen to me, you repent, and you get it right now, or this is what's going to happen. And because they had so sowed into stubbornness and rebellion, they became even that much more defiant. And guess what happened? Everything that had declared to them took place in their life. And they are now still, even into this day, in the repercussions of it. Yep. Why would you do that? Why would you allow the spirit of rebellion to so work in your life? Why? You can say it's this and that and the other thing. It's nothing more than rebellion. It's nothing more than a demon power and a stronghold of rebellion that usually comes out of a spirit of offense. Usually it rises and finds its strength somewhere in unforgiveness and bitterness. Usually that's what you will see religious people stuck in. Some place of unforgiveness and bitterness, the spirit of offense. Tonight, let's get rid of that. There is a general call for everybody to come into a place of greater cooperation with the Holy Spirit. Understanding that you've been set apart to live your life in the Holy Ghost, and God has described that. The Father wants to fit you and equip you to deal with the examination so that you're not overcome by temptation, because there's no temptation which has taken you, which has come against you or come upon you, no examination, no evaluation, except for that which is common unto men. And God has made a way to escape that you may bear it. I mean, there was times in our lives early on in our marriage, and we'd financially or just different things, opposition, you know, the things that the Lord had given us to do, and just, you know, just opposition in the building of this church and other things. And I would just say to Ann, I said, just, baby, just batten down the hatches. We'll ride out the storm. Because sunshine's coming in the morning. Huh? And there was a time where we had in our life, the greater the sacrifice, the greater the blessing. Let's just walk through this fire. Let's walk through this fire because we'll not be burned.
Amen.
Let's walk through this flood because we will not be drowned.
Amen.
We're not going to drown. And we just come to understand there's a way to rely upon God. There's a way to have our focus and have our insight and have our sights placed upon what Father is doing and the blessing that is to come rather than being caught up in the whirlwind of the circumstance and situation. Because we've been set apart by God to do this. And we know that He's made a way of escape so that we can bear this. Because we know that there is something that Father is allowing us to purchase here. Gold tried in the fire. A faith realm that cannot be acquired any other way. Gold tried in the fire. That your faith, that's why Peter says in 1 Peter, he says, we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our salvation. Though now need be, many of you are in heaviness through many different types of evaluations, of examinations, of trials. That the trying of your faith, that the smelting of your faith, that the purifying of your faith, hallelujah, which is much more precious than gold. That perishes even though it be tried by fire. That precious faith that is more eternal and more lasting than something that we can't even conceptualize, gold oxidizing and decaying. Because it's got such a long existence as an element. But compared to faith, it perishes. It will turn to dust. It will disappear. It will go back into the atmosphere. Huh? But faith. Oh, He wants you to be found in the praise and honor and glory at His coming. Listen, dear people, Father wants to equip you for the battle. He wants to fit you for the battle. He wants you to understand how to move into these things. He wants you to understand how to purchase this gold tried in the fire, to purchase this, as it were, faith, this greater depth in Him, this greater resolve and commitment and consecration to trust Him, to walk with Him, to live with Him so that He can live out all that He wants to display to man through you and me. Come on, listen to me now. God, the Holy Ghost is talking to you back there, Kelly. And to you up here. Brittany, Jacqueline. Elise. All of you. Every one of you. Crystal. Everyone. Catherine. Allison. Everyone. This reward, this glory. If we suffer with Him, we should be glorified together with Him. I'll tell you that. Hallelujah. We go through these trials, and we go through this opposition, we go through these threatening things, we go through these almost impossible to deal with things. And we stand fast, worshiping Him, rejoicing in Him, giving thanks to Him, responding properly, responding the way the Holy Ghost has described for us to respond, that He equips us and empowers us to respond, submitting ourselves to God, resisting the devil, walking in forgiveness, walking in mercy, walking in love, walking in joy when everything around you says be sad, walking in peace when everything around you says be fearful and condemned. Hallelujah. Walking in love when everything around you says defend yourself, hate, retaliate. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank You. We thank You, Father, that we are before You now, that Your eyes behold us, that Your eyelids try. We thank You, Father, that Your ears are open unto our prayers, that You evaluate, that You examine. We thank You, Lord, that we are naked and bare and open and transparent before You, with whom we have to do. Jesus. Jesus. My mom brought the thing. Jesus. My mom brought the thing. She pongled the leaf, but I'm thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we ask you in your mercy, shine the floodlight of heaven upon the souls of every person in this place. Father, those strongholds and those things that have held different ones back, that have even become a part of their spirit,
yes,
that are contrary to your will and contrary to your nature.
Yes.
Father, we pray tonight in the name of Jesus that those things would not be wanted anymore in any person's life.
Yes.
That there would be no one that would remain in bondage under the power and the affliction and the torment of hell. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that every person in this place would come respond to you. Lord, we know that you will not defy or transgress anyone's will. But Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we ask you to shake things up. We ask you to shake things up in our lives. Dear people, each one of us have to voluntarily cry out to God the areas that we need to repent for that God makes known by his word.
Yes.
Did you know that the areas that you need to repent for, God makes known by his word?
Yes.
And that the Holy Ghost simply, all the Holy Spirit does is amplify and apply the word of God directly to you. Did you know that? The Holy Spirit is not speaking anything that the word of God didn't declare to you.
Right.
And all we have to do is just respond to the word of God. Say, Father, I'm not going to allow these things in my life. I'm not going to allow anything. I don't want anything in my life that is contrary to you.
Yeah.
I don't want anything in my spirit. I don't want anything in any dimension of my life. I don't want it to participate or commune or interact with anything that isn't a part of that which flows out of heaven.
Amen.
Father, show me how to deal with this. Show me how to deal with that demonic opposition. Those that are under its power may go free. Is there a way, Lord, is there a way to go up against the will of man and somehow change their will or wrestle with their will to where they would surrender to you? And you know what the Lord does in this context is he chastens. Knowing the severity and the judgments of the Lord, we thus persuade men. And whatever it takes tonight, Father, whatever it takes. Shake. Whatever it takes, shake it. Chasten it. Discipline it. Break it. Break it, Father. Break it. That everything in this building, everything in this place, everything in our lives, individually and collectively, may be completely surrendered and yielded to you, Lord.
Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God.
You know, I hope that you can understand the need that the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ has to labor with offenses and to labor with problems and immediately. And that everyone understands that there is nobody that has anything against anyone. It's rather just simply dealing with the enemy of our souls, demon spirits that use men's lives even when men are unaware of it. Men and women. When I say men, I'm talking about men and women. That understanding that we've been equipped by the Holy Ghost to go and destroy all the works of the devil. To seize it, stop it. To cast it out, to break its power. Fundamentally, that's what the church is all about. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name, they cast out devils. Tonight, the Spirit of the Lord wants you to go free. He doesn't want you to live in bondage anymore. He doesn't want you to live in the stronghold of iniquity anymore. He doesn't want you to live in darkness anymore. He doesn't want you to live in blindness of heart anymore. He doesn't want you to live in a place where the Spirit of the Lord is not able to supply you freely and fully and equip you to where that every day you find yourself walking in a deeper fellowship. Walking in a deeper manifestation of His power and His glory. Let me read this verse of Scripture to you in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Holy Ghost, unto obedience. Sanctification, being set apart to live in the Holy Ghost, to be born of the Spirit, to be born of the Holy Ghost. Huh. Set apart to now live in the Holy Ghost, to walk in the Holy Ghost, to be led by the Holy Ghost. As many as led by the Holy Spirit, they're the sons of God. If you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You put on the Lord Jesus Christ, you make no provision to fulfill the lust of the flesh, the desires of the flesh, the things that now works in the children, the disobedience, all that is in the world, that you and I are going to be faced with continually. We're going to be tested and tried and evaluated continually. We're going to confront everything that belongs to the spirit of this world on a continual basis. And the more that we stand against it effectively by the Spirit of the Lord, the stronger we are to deal with it, the more effective we are not only in dealing with it personally, but also in dealing with it in other people's lives. Oh, that there could come a great and glorious revival, that the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, that He's purchased with His own blood and washed with the water of His Word, that it might be without spot or wrinkle, might be seen gloriously in the lives of every church everywhere. But you know what that's going to take? It's going to take people understanding the spirit of this world that works in people who have given themselves to rebellion and disobedience. That thing works in religious people. I watched denominations taken over by it. You don't understand. I know what I'm talking about. I know the spirit that I'm wrestling with right now, I'm dealing with right now. And I know that if it's not confronted and it's not dealt with, it can spread like a disease. And that's why it can't spread in this place, because I'll constantly confront it. I'll constantly deal with it. I will not turn a blind eye to it. You listening to me?
Yes.
Listen to me. To understand, when we recognize the things that are fundamentally coming against our life and stopping us, then we can begin to rely upon the Holy Ghost, and we get passionate about it and say, Lord, I don't want to be stopped by this anymore. I don't want to allow this thing that, you know, this weight and the sin that would beset me. I want to be able to run the race and then begin to effectively deal with it. Well, what happens when the Lord gives you charge of His church for a revival, for revival? First and foremost, a turning back to God, but a revival wherein all those things that He placed within the church when he purchased the church and when the church was born in the Holy Ghost may begin to be activated and fully realized. In the midst of a community, in the midst of a city, in the midst of a nation, a little small church in Wales in 1904 suddenly began to flow and function in this moving of the Spirit of the Lord, and it changed the nation, and it changed the nations around them. Wales was changed. And so, in knowing, just like understanding when things are coming out against us individually, and we know, hey, we understand this is what's holding me back. This is what's stopping me. I'm not going to allow it to hold me back. I'm not going to allow it to stop me anymore. I'm going to be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. I'm taking this thing's head.
Yeah.
Well, in the same token, I can see things that are stopping the church. They don't work outside of an individual, outside of a human being. They work through a human being. And so I say, well, am I so evil? No, you're so ignorant. No, you're so unaware. Somebody said, I don't want to be ignorant anymore. You know what? Submission will help you not be ignorant anymore. One day I was walking around saying, Lord, how did I get so blessed? He said, you took heed unto my word. You obeyed me. You obeyed me even when you didn't understand it. You obeyed me even when it didn't suit you. Huh? There was times the Lord said love, and I thought, oh, we should be surely calling fire down out of heaven right now. He said, no, you love him and you show mercy to him and you show forgiveness. Now you have a responsibility, if you care about the Lord Jesus Christ and His church, to come and join up together with me to deal with this thing, and especially if the thing's going on in your life. If you're the one. The Lord would deal with you again and again and again and again. Huh? Personally, individually, but there comes a time where He just says, listen, somebody else is going to have to talk to you now. You won't listen to me. You can just write me off. Now Nathan's going to come get in your face and say you're the man. Because just as the individual must be separated to live in their life in the Holy Ghost, the church must also be separated, set apart to living and being and functioning and having all of its purpose and all of its activity and function in the fires of the Holy Ghost. When we do these things on an individual basis, we become very sensitive to them on a collective basis. If we don't do them on an individual basis, we live a religious life, then we're going to have a religious meeting.
Yeah.
And that's what we want. If we live a Holy Ghost life submitted to the Holy Ghost, we set apart to live in this realm of the Holy Ghost, then we want a Holy Ghost meeting.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what? I'm going to walk around living in the Holy Ghost, come to a meeting and say, no, Holy Spirit, you can't function in my life now? Whoa, there's no way, man. I'm walking in the Holy Ghost, living in the realm of the Spirit, interacting in this fellowship with Him. I expect it to be greater in the meeting. And if I feel something imposing, listen, if I felt something imposing in my personal life, that flow of the Holy Ghost, I'm going to deal with it radically. Do you think I'm going to deal with it radically? I'm going to deal with it radically. And I come to the meeting, and I feel something messing with the flow of the Holy Ghost. You think I'm going to deal with it? I'm on it. With everything that I have, I'm on it. I'm going to stop it. You're messing with the flow. Ha ha. You're messing with the flow. Somebody said, I don't want to mess with the flow. Well, good. Because you stop messing with the flow here, you're going to start understanding the things that are keeping you from walking with God out there. And that's what it's about. We're here to help you. We're here to help you to understand how to be obedient children. Hallelujah. Not fashioning yourself like everybody does out there in the world and how people respond to a person who's given them instruction and given them correction. you get a group of people together in the world, right, and you start correcting them. You're going to have a riot on your hands. Huh? You're not going to have people saying, oh, please correct me. Unless you're telling them that if they do these particular things, they're going to make $10 million. Then they may be willing to be corrected. Then they may be willing to modify the behavior. But not, no, you know what? If you bring a bunch of people into a room and you tell them, listen, if you just start being happy all the time and being generous and being kind and learning how to be just very gracious to people and learning how not to be in a bad mood. And if you're in a bad mood, they'll go out in front of people until you get in a good mood. And they teach you how to think about good things and good thoughts so you can get all happy and learn how you can put on a happy face. Then you can be successful. People aren't going to do it. They can't do it. They can't do it. They live under the emotion and the conflict of their own souls, right? That even if you tell them you could do this, even if you said you can make $1 billion if you can learn how to be kind and happy all the time and not be moody. If you can learn how to be generous and blessing and a blessing to people. They can't do it. They can't do it. They live under the torment of their own souls. There's very few people who can do that naturally, kind as it were. They just have an ability somehow to be a politician and smile. But here the Lord transformed our hearts, transformed our lives, so that we can be obedient children. Obedient to who? Obedient to the Holy Ghost. How do you know whether you're being obedient or not? Are you doing His word? Are you living at His word? Hallelujah. You know, if I go and I pray for somebody who doesn't want prayer, ain't going to do them any good. Did you know that? If someone comes up and they want prayer and they don't have any faith, they don't believe, that's going to be a very difficult one to get change to come into their life as well. But we just have a hungry heart. And this morning somebody brought a young man whose leg had, I guess, been amputated, and he said, I want you to pray for me. I have an infection in my leg. And I can't get a prosthetic until this infection is gone. And as soon as he said that, I felt the anointing. You know why I felt the anointing? Because it was faith. Yes. Yes. I didn't have to wonder or discern if there was faith or not. I feel the anointing. Yep. Anointing to pray for someone to be healed. Yep. And so as soon as I touched him, the glory of the Lord came upon him. He felt the glory come all over him. I felt the glory. I said, the infection has gone out of your body. And I said, why don't you just go ahead and walk this relationship without the Lord, walk out this relationship with the Lord, that faith may grow in your spirit, and you may mature so you don't even need a prosthetics. The Lord just let this egg lay grow on out. And he was sitting over there just rejoicing in the Lord, and he started thinking about everything that was possibly wrong with him. He wanted more prayer for everything else. Said, I've got cataracts, pray for them. I mean, it's beautiful. The simplest little bit of faith, the simplest little bit of yieldedness to God. Just crack the door a little bit. Behold, he says, I stand at the door and I knock. This is Jesus. To a rebellious church, a church that will not listen. A church that says that they got it all, and they got it right, you know. That they can see. We see you telling you, you saying is blind. We can see. You saying, don't have it put together. We clothed, we right, we rich. He says, no, you poor, you blind, you miserable, you naked, and you wretched. Church. But he said, in that state, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Even in that state, the Lord doesn't say, look, you, this is who you are, man. You just messed up bad from the head to the toe. You think you're right, but you're not. And then just walk away and say, forget about you. I'm not interested. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear, if any man will open up the door, just open up the door. How hard is that? How hard is it? Just open up the door of your heart. People get themselves into a ditch and into a rut. And they blame it on God and blame it on people around them. And it was their own decisions. They're in the rut and they're in the mess because they made wrong decisions. God told you to do something different. You didn't do what He told you to do. He told you to behave differently, make other choices. You didn't do it. You choose other wrong choices, and now you got the problem. And now you're going to be a prisoner of the problem and blame it on everybody else because, you know, things aren't going so good because you're eating the fruits of your doings. You know what the Lord says? He said He's not going to be mocked. He said, you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap a whirlwind of corruption. Tonight, just come out of the ditch. Behold, He stands at the door. Not all you got to do is just throw your hands up in the air and say, okay, Lord, I'm not living this life anymore. I want You. I surrender my heart to You. That's all you got to do. How hard is that? Did you know that hell is filled with people tonight who would not do that? So simple. So easy. You just got to release the stuff to the Lord. You just got to release your life to the Lord. If you're not willing to do that, at least don't tell people that you're a Christian. Just tell them you're backslidden. Please. You know what I'm saying? Say, I'm a backslider, you know. I just decided I'm not going to walk with God. And in that way, you're not false witness, bringing reproach against the kingdom. You know what I'm saying? Jesus. Well, I spent most of this meeting on about two people, one especially, and I still got nothing. And I'm broken. I'm broken in my spirit for the unwillingness to respond to the Holy Ghost. And I hurt for you. Because how can you say no to Jesus? How can you say no to the Holy Ghost with such defiance? I did not understand that. The only thing I could do is I think about how Lucifer stood in the presence of the Lord for so many years. And then he rebelled against God. I don't understand it. I just love Him too much. I never want to understand defiance against God. I never want to be able to understand how that a word of the Lord could be coming to me and I harden my heart against His word and not respond. But for everyone who is here tonight, who's willing to yield yourself to the Spirit of the Lord, God is calling out. He's crying, come over here, stand with me. For everyone who's willing to walk with the Lord and to walk in the things of the Spirit and give yourself over to the realms of heaven, God's come with all His glory, with all of His power to enable you. Everybody, would you stand with me? Stand with me. Ha, bramamon sandeste, perineste. Kieramosamba deste, kieparonase. Lebendere beste predeste de cura se parra de defi. Ibrara se derete kishti. Let me say this, though. Let me say this. You know what I am so blessed about? I've seen about a dozen people over the past couple of months in this place completely and totally broken free from the things that have held them in prison, has kept them from going forward. That is such a blessing. It's such a blessing. Such a blessing. I'm going after a realm in God to where 100% of the people are healed, 100% of the people are saved, 100% of the people are set free. I believe with all of my heart that if the church would simply allow the Holy Spirit to take full control of the meeting, that everything in this nation would be turned around. But I recognize that that will never happen until each individual is willing to allow the Holy Spirit to take full control of their lives. And they're going to be formed and fashioned after His likeness and after the things that He's described. They're going to give themselves to holy emotions. They're going to hunger and thirst for the things that belong to the spiritual. They're going to covet the spiritual things. They're going to covet spiritual things is simply talking about the things that belong to the Holy Ghost. This is the spiritual things, the things that belong to heaven. They're going to desire the spiritual. Covet the spiritual. Covet the areas of love and mercy and forgiveness. Covet the areas of all that He empowers us to do, to love righteousness and hate iniquity, to have a drawing and attraction towards that which is pure and holy, rather than a draw and attraction towards those things which are not pure and not holy. Oh, Ramama Zadeya Pita. Oh, Ramama Mama Zabrebe Dishi Britushta. Hallelujah. 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 Now, let me say this. Because I hear the Spirit of the Lord telling me not to deal with it anymore. So I'm not going to. I'm done with it. But I wanted to say this to you. The Word of God will build you up. The Word of God will build you up in such a way that you will step into the inheritance that He has for all of His holy ones that are in the light. You listen to me. These things will equip you to be able to deal with the opposition that has come up against you to stop you from being that which God has called you to be and living in all of the blessings that He has freely given. Because the Word of God abides in you, because you allow yourself to be built up by the Word of God, because you give yourself over to this realm of prayer and interaction with the Lord, with the Holy Spirit, with the Lord Jesus Christ, with the Father that takes place in prayer, the kind of prayer that Jesus prayed when He went up on the mount, when He was transfigured before the Lord, the kind of prayer that we understand when we pray in by the Spirit. Hallelujah. 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 When you be willing to just, no matter where you're at, be quickened by the Holy Ghost that calls your feet to begin to dance, and begin to move around, you begin to joy, and begin to rejoice. Because you set apart to that. You set apart to that. And when you're constantly being filled up with the good things of heaven, you're not going to want the bad things of this world. I mean, because when you're not filled up with the good things of heaven, you'll think that the bad things of this world are good. When you're filled up with the good things of heaven, then it's very apparent that the bad things of this world are bad. You don't want them. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.